Thank you. Thank you. Escuchamos bien, ¿verdad?
No introduction with the pioneer and the world leader in the study of vertigo balance disorders. He's a professor of neurology and clinical neurophysiology, Department of Neurology and German Center for Vertigo and Balance Disorders, University of Munich, Germany. His particular area of interest is the diagnosis and therapy of vestibular, ocular motor, and cerebellar disorders. He has currently authored 447 top-end listed papers and 5 books on vertigo, dizziness, and ocular motor disorders. The most recent one published in Sweden in 2023, Vertigo and Dizziness, Common Compliance. He is currently editor in chief of Frontiers in Neurology, joint chief editor of the Journal of Neurology, and a member of the editorial board of Neurology. He has received many clinical and scientific awards, including the Healthy Kylan Award 2016, best teacher by the German Neurological Society, an investigator award of the European Academy of Neurology 2019, and the Gallagher's Bond Award 2020 for the Commonwealth districts. Let's welcome Professor Michael Strupp.
Thank you, colleagues, for your kind introduction. It's a pleasure and honor to be here today, and we have to celebrate something evidently official inauguration of a vertigo clinic, which has already been run by Dr. Ravi and his team. But today was the press release and the official announcement. So I noticed that this is going to be a heterogeneous audience. And based on that, I'd like to begin with some basic questions about how to take patient history, about how to examine the vestibular and the ocular motor system in patients with vertigo and dizziness. So imagine I come to you and I'm suffering from dizziness. What do you want to know? We have more handhelds, microphones, so that we can go through. What do you want to know? I'm dizzy now. I can. What is your answer?
That particular feature that is three.
Yeah. What from the patient history do you want to know?
Duration.
Oh, time course is extremely important because vestibular syndromes can present in three ways, similar to headache. Patients can have acute onset, longer lasting symptoms. Acute vestibular syndrome, as in stroke or vestibular neuritis. The second presentation is recurrent episodes of vertigo. If they last less than a minute, what are the differential diagnoses? Short, recurrent episodes of vertigo. What do you diagnose?
Depending on the difference and particularly change of the position, patients.
Okay, I just talk about the time course. So BPPV is one option, as you mentioned. Patient can also have vestibular paroxysmia or superior canal eustachian syndrome, or syndrome of the third mobile windows. If the episodes last many minutes to hours, what are the two most important differential diagnoses? Veneers or vestibular migraine. Okay. And if a patient has persisting symptoms for 5 years, what are the differential diagnoses? I come to you and I tell you I'm dizzy now for 5 years. Bad beginning of the day. What are the differential diagnoses? Cerebellar dizziness is a very good answer. You have 7 eye movements, and then you notice there's saccadic smooth pursuit, gazy wolf, nice tackles, downbeat, nice tackles, left visceral fixation, suppression of the VOR. Good. Any other options for persisting dizziness? Bilateral vestibulopathy, functional dizziness, neurodegenerative diseases, namely movement disorders or cerebellar dizziness. Okay, the time pools. Any other aspects you want to know? It's your course, not my course. Please, I need you. No, someone else. It's not a one-man show. From the left side, the left wing, political left wing. What is your opinion?
Is it a true vertigo or is it a disease?
Okay, I wouldn't say true vertigo, but the direction is correct, the type of symptoms. And basically, we can have spinning vertigo, indicating a dysfunction of a semicircular canal or its pathways, or we can have dizziness and postural imbalance. Okay, so we have time course, we have type. What else? The right wing. I'm dizzy now. What do you want to know? You will have to make the diagnosis. Triggers, modulating factors. Do the symptoms occur spontaneously, or are they induced by changes of head or body position, or the patient has no symptoms while sitting or lying down, but when he gets up, then he feels dizzy, worse in darkness, uneven ground, typical of bilateral vestibulopathy. Okay, and the fourth category, accompanying symptoms. They can arise from the ear, evident. They can arise from the brainstem or cerebellum, as in stroke. They can be typical of migraine, or vestibular migraine, and unspecific nausea and vomiting. So four categories: time course, type, triggers, accompanying symptoms. Now, you like to examine the vestibular system, bedside examination. Which tests do you have in hand? What do we examine? I'm dizzy now. Spinning vertigo, nausea, vomiting. You examine me. What do you all have to look for? Nystagmus. What is a nystagmus? What's the definition? Left wing. It's a periodic, normally involuntary eye movement. If it's a jerky nystagmus, you have a slow phase and a fast phase. And for you to remember, the fast phase is always beating towards the more active labyrinth, double A. Got it? AA. Right, Indian doctors remember that. Good. What else do you examine? And we do later at the end a hands-on course. What? Hearing is fine. Stretching. Good.
Cerebellar signs.
Now we talk about the vestibular system. I'm with you with cerebellar signs. Well, you examine the function of the vestibular ocular reflex with the head impulse test. You do the diagnostic positioning maneuvers, and you do the wrong work. Again, four tests. So, nystagmus, head impulse test, positioning maneuvers, and wrong work. That's four key questions, four tests. Takes about 8 minutes, and you have the diagnosis. If you don't have it, it's going to be difficult. Okay? These are the keys to the diagnosis to open two doors to the diagnosis. And we have just 8 frequent vestibular disorders. So mathematically spoken, 4 + 4 = 8. And that's easy. Okay, good. I'm going now to talk about peripheral vestibular disorders. And the videos and the photographs are most often taken from our upcoming book produced in Chennai by Springer Nature next year. 400 pages, 200 videos. So I think it's the basic of every vestibular disease. Yeah.
Some doctors connected on, online as well, just for information.
I know, but that will be even more difficult to get their answers and questions. During the Q&A session, we can have that in the chat room. Thank you. Okay, so this is related to what I said before. Peripheral and central vestibular disorders can be classified based on the presentation into simply three categories, which is very simple for you, but you have to understand that. So the first category is loss of function of the organs of balance, bilateral vestibulopathy. Most often idiopathic, most common cause is gentamicin. You have no organs of balance, you have no symptoms while you sit or lie down as you do now, but as soon as you get up and you feel dizzy, it's getting worse in darkness. Then we have the patient with an acute unilateral lesion, acute unilateral vestibulopathy, vestibular neuritis. This leads to vestibular tone imbalance between the right and the left aberrant. Often patients have an acute onset of longer lasting spinning vertigo, several days. But the same you can also have in a patient with a brainstem or cerebellar fracture. We'll talk about that in the second lecture. And the third presentation is the most frequent one, recurrent episodes of vertigo. What are the underlying diseases? Any ideas? Which diseases manifest with recurrent episodes of vertigo? BPPV, Meniere's disease, vestibular migraine, vestibular paroxysmia, syndrome of the third mobile windows. So the vast majority is characterized by recurrent episodes. And in contrast to what is commonly believed, it's mainly due from excitation. In BPPV, you have most often excitation. In Meniere, initially excitation. In vestibular paroxysmia, excitation. In vestibular migraine, excitation. So be aware of that. So the system can be excited, which leads to a vestibular tone imbalance and episodes of vertigo. And here you see the underlying diseases. There are just six frequent, and this is what we are going to focus on. Six frequent peripheral vestibular diseases with the underlying pathophysiology and etiology. So it's very transparent. BPPV, otoconia, most often the posterior canal. I'm going to show you new, very effective maneuvers, which are better than the EPE maneuver, as we showed in two studies. Then we have Meniere's disease and lymphatic high drops. We have syndrome of the third mobile windows with a bony defect, most often on top of the anterior canal. Then this is not coronavirus, this is herpes virus, and this leads to vestibular neuritis. Vestibular paroxysmia, analogous to trigeminal neuralgia, neurovascular cross compression, as glossopharyngeal neuralgia, as hemifacial spasm, and of course, trigeminal neuralgia. And then bilateral vestibulopathy, in most cases, we don't know the underlying disease, but we found in about 15% of our patients now a specific mutation. Good. Here you see the data from our dizziness center in 40,000 patients. They were all systematically examined and treated. And here you see in blue how relevant all of these peripheral vestibular disorders are. They cover more than 50% of all patients. You can also see number one is functional dizziness. And then we have BPPV, central vestibular syndromes, vestibular migraine, and the rest is peripheral. So peripheral is the major focus. And what will help you in your clinical practice very much is the work we have elaborated over the last 12 months, because we have redefined all the vestibular disorders. So reclassification of vestibular disorders. And the nice thing is, you can download them all from the website of the Journal of Vestibular Research. And then you're really up to date for your clinical practice, but also if you like to make a clinical trial. These are the internationally approved criteria. Good. So all of the diseases which I'm going to present to you will be introduced by a video quiz to keep you alert, to have your full attention, and that you can make the diagnosis on your own. Then I will present the current diagnostic criteria, the pathophysiology, etiology, subsequently the current treatment,
and also some news on the treatment of BPPV and also news on the treatment of Meniere's disease, for instance. Okay, listen to the first patient and try to make the diagnosis.
Miss Barter, you've come to us because of dizziness. When did this all start?
2.5 days ago.
Was this vertigo or was it a staggering dizziness or unsteadiness when walking?
Vertigo and unsteadiness when walking.
Is it still continuing?
Yes.
Did you have other symptoms apart from vertigo?
Nausea and vomiting.
In addition to the vertigo, did you experience any loss of hearing, pressure in your ears or tinnitus?
No.
When you felt dizzy, did you experience any facial numbness, paralysis, loss of coordination?
No.
Loss of sensation in your arm and legs?
No.
Apart from feeling dizzy, did you have a headache or sensitivity to light or noise?
Headache.
When did the headache appear?
After about a day.
Thank you very much.
So, what do you diagnose? What do you diagnose? A, B, C, D, E? Any alternative explanations? You're not sure? What do you do as next step? You examine the patient, and that will give you the diagnosis. Look at her eyes. What do you see? My sentence is beating through the right. Which labyrinth is more active? The right one. Okay, good.
There was no skew deviation, that means no vertical deviation. When the patient looks to the right, the intensity increases, which is typical. When she looks to the left, there must be no direction changing diastacles or no diastacles, and there's nothing. Otherwise, this would be central. Which test do you do next? Look at the function of the VOR. Which test do you do next? The hand pulse test. And that's pathological to the left. Okay, got it? So what do you diagnose now? What do you diagnose? You have 5 options before, you notice that? So what do you diagnose? A, B, C, D, E? Okay, acute unilateral vestibulopathy. Typical history. What is important for you to note, namely when you are in the emergency room, ask the patient for potential accompanying symptoms from the ear, from the brainstem, the cerebellum, hear me such and such, but also related to migraine. The headache appeared 2 days later. It was not very intense. So it was a good differential diagnosis. Okay, good. So this is acute unilateral vestibulopathy. And here you see another patient, the clinical features. He's looking straight ahead. You see a very tight, nice diastacles, very tiny. And now you see it better. His collar is on proportional. To the left, which labyrinth is more active, left or right? The left one. Okay, good. And then you would expect a pathological hand pulse test to the right. Now you see it. Ideally, you'll give your hand pulse test, then you get a much better result. Okay, good. So horizontal torsion, spontaneous diastacles, fast pace towards the more active labyrinth, partially suppressed by visual fixation, pathological head pulse test to the left, no central signs, no pronounced skew deviation, no gazy book diastacles. Okay, and here are the diagnostic criteria, which, as I said, you can download from the website of the Journal of Vestibular Research. So they're very clinically oriented, very pragmatic. So it's an acute onset of longer lasting spinning vertigo. No central signs, pathological head pulse test, peripheral vestibular spontaneous diastacles. That's it. What about the underlying etiology and pathophysiology? We had done a lot of molecular biology studies. We got material from the forensic medicine department. And then we found in healthy subjects, vestibular healthy subjects, and about 60% herpes simplex virus 1 in the vestibular ganglion neurons.
A more recent but brainless approach is genome-wide association studies. You have 6,000 healthy individuals, and let's say 200 with a certain disease. And then you look for single nucleotide variants. And we were not disappointed when they were found in the host factor for herpes simplex virus 1 replication, which strongly supports the idea that this is due to a herpes simplex virus replication. And that was confirmed by another study here. How do we treat these patients? Well, we have four options. First, steroids. You give 100 milligrams per day for 3 days, then 80 for 3 days, and so on. And this is supported by, in the meantime, 3-meter analysis, which showed that the steroids are effective, as we demonstrated in this paper in the New England Journal in 2004. Treatment of symptoms, we talk about improvement of central compensation by vestibular exercise. Now we come to a critical point. Which drugs do you give? The patient comes with severe nausea, vomiting, vertigo, and doesn't feel well. What is your favorite? Any drugs to reduce the symptoms? What do you give? Nothing? What would you take if you are a patient? Diamine hydronates. It's an histamine 1 antagonist, and there's a very high density of H1 receptors in the vestibular motor neurons that reduces the vestibular tone imbalance. 1 to 300 milligrams per day. Ondansetron, you give normally in chemotherapy, but it works amazingly well, 4 to 8 milligrams up to 3 times per day. You can give benzodiazepines, but there's a long list of drugs which I do not recommend because this can cause persisting Parkinsonia. And here are the regular suspects. Cinarizine plus flunarizine is extremely bad. Cinarizine and also proparacine. They all act on the dopamine receptor. And we know our patients, they often take the medication much longer. And then they end up as non-responsive Parkinson's syndrome. Okay, good. Now we talk a little bit about central compensation and the effects of drug. Betahistine is by far the most frequently used drug whatsoever. We did this survey in 2013, and 65% of all doctors prescribe betahistine for various types of vestibular symptoms. And we were able to reevaluate the effects of this drug in an animal model. What we do chemical unilateral laparotomy. And then the animal spins around for a few days. And that's an ideal clean model to look whether any drug has any impact on central compensation, positive or negative. And I'd just like to show you the data from betahistine. On the left side, you see an animal not treated, and the right side, an animal treated, same day. You see the animal is much more agile when treated than the other one. This is one single animal. It doesn't help. If you quantify that, you will notice that day 7, the treated animal walks 5 times faster as your patient when sufficiently treated with the high dose of betahistine. We were also able to localize within the small brain of the rat, the site of action. And this explains the double effect that betahistine, which you see here in yellow, is the relatively increased glucose metabolism. So in the acute stage on a left-sided neurectomy, betahistine increases the activity of the ipsilateral vestibular nucleus, and thereby it reduces the vestibular tone imbalance, which improves the symptoms. Later on, please come in. Later on, it activates the cerebellum and spinal trigeminal nucleus neurons. And this improves the positive effect on central compensation. So it has a double effect, and it's very helpful for the treatment of symptoms and central compensation. And now I'd like to summarize the stimulant neuritis treatment, steroids, diamine hydronate for a short period of time, beta-histine in a high dosage, or the combination with the monoamine oxidase B inhibitor, I'll come to that later, and improvement of central compensation of vestibular exercises. So that's the strategy. Any questions from your side on vestibular neuritis? Anything? Did you see any patients? They are there, evidently. And they will show up in the emergency room. And we have to diagnose them and to differentiate between vestibular neuritis and brainstem or cerebellar stroke. We'll come to that in the second lecture.
The duration is quite prolonged in some patients.
Yes, there are some patients who compensate slowly. Elderly patients, patients with a subcortical vascular encephalopathy, and those who do not do enough exercises. If there's a secondary deterioration, patients can have a post-infectious BPPV, 50%, or they develop secondary functional limits. So these are the two explanations for a prolonged course. Now I'm going to present you two typical, atypical patient histories. Listen to the patient on the left.
Dr. Minnesweiler, why don't you come to our hospital, please?
I have a sort of dizziness and imbalance.
For how many days or weeks?
3 or 4 weeks.
Did you have that before?
I had that months ago and even years ago.
Do you also have spinning vertigo?
No spinning.
Do you have positional vertigo?
No.
Thank you very much.
So, what do you diagnose? Difficult, huh? We all have these patients. And I will have a very important take-home message for you in the context of this patient. Now listen to another patient. She's from Northern Italy.
Mrs. Brunner, you have been suffering from dizziness and postural imbalance for 3 years. Can you describe your symptoms, please?
Well, when I wake up in the morning, it doesn't happen every morning, but most mornings, and I feel like a heavy head and an unsteadiness, a fear of falling. And if I only should pick something up from the floor or move my head, then it's very unpleasant. It takes a little while until I feel well again.
Do you also have some headache or pressure in the head?
Headaches, not really. I feel like a heavy pressure at the end of the skull, coming up from the neck, and the pressure in the head in the center of the skull. And when I massage it gently for a couple of minutes, and it goes away.
How is it when you stand and walk?
When I stand and walk, well, at times I'm totally normal. I don't feel anything. But when I have this morning dizziness, like I have had this morning, then it's still on now. Now it's 10 o'clock and I still feel this. And I have the feeling that stress and fear. I had a fear to visit the doctor and stuff. But then it's worse. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So, what do you diagnose? Any ideas? What is your suggestion as a differential diagnosis? Both had BPPV. And this underlines for your clinical practice how important it is that you do the diagnostic maneuvers in every patient, independent of the history. Both had BPPV. Were treated within 1 day, 2 days, and then it was gone. So it's extremely important, yeah? Every patient needs diagnostic therapeutic maneuvers. And now we come to some simple but clinically relevant questions. If you do the diagnostic maneuver, which side first? What is the angular velocity? What is the duration? And posterior canal only? When you don't know the affected side from the patient history, where do we start, right or left? on the right side. Why? If you have your heart on the right side, that means on the left side, then you sleep more often on the right side. And therefore the risk is higher that the right side affected. It's actually twice as often. And therefore you start on the right side. Another thing is the angular velocity. We simulated that in the mechanical model. Same for the duration and posterior canal anterior horizontal recombination. So this has turned out to be an extremely helpful model. And one of the key findings was, if you turn the labyrinth by, let's say, 90 degrees, the crystals move only 60 degrees. And as I noticed this, I immediately transformed the Simmel into the Simmel plus maneuver for the diagnosis as well as for the treatment. And this you see here, this is now the new diagnostic Simmel plus maneuver. This has overextend the head by 60 degrees. And then the crystals move another 60 degrees into the direction they should move. And this should have a positive impact on the diagnostic maneuvers. You see here on the left side a regular Simmel, on the right side a Simmel plus with another 60 degrees. The impact, however, is much higher when you have a look at the therapeutic maneuvers. Because if you add another 60 degrees, look here on the right, the crystals are beyond the vertex of the canal. And if you then move the patient by 240 degrees into the opposite direction, the chance is much higher that they move into the direction they should move. Got it? Good. And this is something we also simulated. And then you can see what is really going on in the labyrinth. So these simulations are very helpful. They also show you how slowly the crystals are moving. You see it here on the right side. And therefore, each position has to be kept 60 seconds. That's very important. And then after 60 seconds, the patient moves toward the opposite side. And then the crystals are theoretically beyond, as you see here, the vertex of the canal, which, as I said before, should increase the chance that the crystals move into the direction they should move. You see that here. Okay, that was the theory. But now listen to one patient who was treated that way, here on the right side.
You have been suffering from dizziness on your right side for many years and have had recurring symptoms the last few weeks and months.
Yes, that's right.
What is known as Simmel plus maneuver for the first time. How was that now when we treated you with it?
It is a very severe reaction. I've never had anything like this in the past. It was the first time that I had it so bad that I didn't know where left and right or top or bottom was at all. It felt as if the whole building was falling on me.
And during the second rest, was there anything else that may have been
triggered? It was actually gone.
Thank you very much.
So, single cases are not very helpful. And we did a randomized prospective study, 3 countries. And was a very simple design. 9 maneuvers per day, Simmel versus Simmel plus. And the results were very convincing. You could reduce the time it takes until a patient is free of symptoms to 50%, from 3.6 to 1.8 days, which is quite dramatic. And we performed an analogous study, same design, and compared Epley, which is very popular in many countries of the world, except continental Europe, with the Simmel plus, and same design. And first of all, we could replicate the results of the first trial for the Simmel plus, which was a great relief. So the data are solid. And there was a reduction also from 3.3 to 1.9 days. So the Simmel plus is also more effective than the Epley maneuver. Another thing which has turned out to be very relevant is the angle of the head. When I examine and treat, for instance, for right posterior canal BPPD, I turn the patient's head 45 degrees to the left. Why do you do this head turn? To bring the canal in the plane of the movement, because the vertical canals are tilted by 45 degrees from the frontal plane. and then the canal is in the plane of movement and gravitational forces can act. If you're 10 to 20 degrees or more beyond that, then the maneuvers will not be effective. My youngest daughter, Amelie Christine, programmed this app for patients at the age of 17. It clearly shows the patient, and the English voice is from Michael Halmagyi, who described the Halmagyi head impulse test for the first time. And it tells the patient on how to properly perform the maneuvers. Another thing, we all talk about remote management, turned out to be very helpful. Look at the patient on the left.
So
this couple is performing the therapeutic maneuvers, and you see this could not work. They're very much engaged. They took double video with the eyes and the movements, but you see this cannot work. On the right side, you see this new Simon Plus maneuver in a patient who performed it in a correct way. And then after 60 seconds, move back to 240 degrees. So that will work. And therefore, remote management is extremely helpful, namely in patients who have persisting symptoms. I quickly demonstrate this Simon Plus maneuver now. Come to the podium. This table is ideal. Are you going to do the next one? Okay. Okay, sit on the table. Take off your glasses, please. A little bit here. Move the microphone, please. Okay, if I examine and treat his right posterior canal, I turn the patient's head 45 degrees to the left. You extend your arm, and then you simply go down as much as possible. That's all. Yeah? Not very spectacular, but extremely helpful. And after 1 minute, move the whole patient back 40 degrees into the opposite direction. And then the patient can sit up. That's all. Thank you. Nothing particular, but highly clinically relevant. So to summarize these two trials, the Simon Plus is superior to the Epley and the Simon maneuver. It confirms the prediction of the biophysical model. Keep the angle precise and use the Simon Plus from now on. Now look at this patient here, recurrent episodes of vertigo. What do we diagnose? What is the direction of the nystagmus? Just describe it. What is the direction? Linear, horizontal. Which canal is affected? Horizontal. Okay. Good. And now we have two types of horizontal canal DPPV. One is very frequent, canalolithiasis. The crystals move freely within the canal. And what is rare is cupelolithiasis. And clinically, they are the mirror image of each. And here you see another patient. So right ear down, left ear down, linear horizontal nystagmus, and the affected side is the side with a higher intensity. Secondly, in canalolithiasis, you have a geotropic nystagmus. So this is what you have to remember. Geotropic nystagmus, affected side is the side with a higher intensity. And this is relevant because the maneuvers for the right and the left are mirror images. So we have to find out which side is affected. We have done a lot of simulations on the diagnostic maneuvers, and they have been very enlightening. We also published 2 years ago this review and simulated everything. And this is what we now recommend, the modified roll maneuver. Remove all the crystals. The patient first turns the head toward the affected side, and then in 90 degree steps turns toward the healthy side. And then you remove the crystals. That's theory. Now, tricky question. What is the orientation of the horizontal canal? Is it earth horizontal in a head upright position? ENT, what do you think? What is the orientation? It's elevated by 25 degrees. This is so-called Frankfurt line. And this we have to consider during the diagnostic and therapeutic maneuvers. Because otherwise, you remember what was true for the posterior canal is also true for the horizontal canal. And here you see a precise simulation how the head has to be turned during these maneuvers. Because you see, once it's up and then it's down again. That's a very complicated 3D movement of the head to have an optimal position. And this explains why in the normal conditions, all of these maneuvers are not really good. And over a glass of wine, together with the physicists from Austria, we got an idea, and we just got a patent yesterday on this new idea. And this is here shown, and Indian doctors were also involved. So I got the idea after a presentation. I was criticized by a physicist, then we had a glass of wine, and then we ended up with this particular pillow. It's for the right and the left side, and the effect is very simple. You see here all these angles which change during the maneuvers. It keeps during the treatment maneuvers the horizontal canal always vertical. Because if you don't do that and elevate the head 30 degrees in the other position, it will be 60 degrees out of movement. And as we noticed that, that was easy. And I hope it will be produced soon. I don't know what the price is. Maybe it will be produced.
This is Lila. You were diagnosed with benign paroxysmal positioning vertigo in January this year. And in February, you also had recurrent attacks of vertigo. But what was the difference in February?
The difference was that I felt permanently dizzy. Every time I moved my head, I felt dizzy. There was just one position where I could not feel dizziness at all. And that was when I looked just straight with that position of my head. And if I moved upwards or downwards, I felt dizziness again.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That's a strange history, isn't it? Any ideas? Permanent spinning vertigo, like alcohol-induced nystagmus. Now look at a patient that's even more confusing, but I would solve the problem. So now the head is in a normal upright position. What do you see? What is the direction of the nystagmus? It's linear horizontal, to not be just misdiagnosed as vestibular neuritis. So, and now speaking to the right. Now the left ear is down. It's speaking to the right. Do you see that? That's a lean and go test. I will first confuse you and then we will clarify that. Now the right ear is down and it's beating upward. So it's an apogeotropic nystagmus. Now the head is bent forward. It's beating to the left. And when the head is overextended backward, it's beating to the right, and this is the affected side. So what do we diagnose? Well, we have posterior canal already, we have canalolithiasis. What is the diagnosis? Cupololithiasis. Cupololithiasis is characterized in a head upright position by a permanent nystagmus because the crystals are attached to the cupola and this leads to permanent deflection. That's it. Can cause a lot of confusion. Treatment of choice is you transform the cupola into a canalolithiasis by head shape. And then you treat the patient as though the patient had canalolithiasis. Now look at this patient here. Supine, head straight ahead, overextended. What do you diagnose? What is the direction of the nystagmus? Is it horizontal or vertical? Vertical. Is it horizontal or vertical canal BPPV? A vertical canal BPPV. And which one? We have already the posterior horizontal, and now it is the anterior canal. It's a linear horizontal downward eating nystagmus. And there's one thing which often causes confusion, even under experts. And this is the torsional component of this bloody nystagmus. It's very easy to explain. If the patient looks into the direction of the affected canal, let's say the left anterior, looking 45 degrees to the left, you have a pure vertical nystagmus. If you look to the right or left from that, then you get a torsional component, and that's very confusing. So my recommendation is look into the direction of the canal, left and right, and then you have a clear picture of the diagnosis. This torsional component always causes confusion and is often wrongly reported in papers. Okay, in the plane of the canal, pure vertical downwardly booting nystagmus, that's anterior canal BBB. And we have simulated all the maneuvers and the regular so-called Iacovino maneuver is not working. And it may even lead to a canal conversion, or it may even lead to the fact that the crystals are not moving at all. And therefore these simulations are very helpful. And based on these simulation, here you see on the left side, now the crystals move into the posterior canal. Here you see the crystals are falling back, so that doesn't work. So if you simplify this maneuver, it's even more effective. So diagnostic maneuvers, supine head overextended by 30 to 45 degrees. That's the beginning. And subsequently, the patient should just simply sit upright, and then the crystals fall into the direction they should fall. You see here, and that's a simplification of the Iacovino maneuver. And then the final step, bend the head forward. Another thing which is literally in every mouth is vitamin D. And maybe from China, a lot of studies got the impression that vitamin D deficiency is a risk factor for BBBB. We had a different approach. We did a study in 680 patients. We looked at the brainless, we looked at the vitamin D level. In patients with BBBB and patients with other vestibular disorders and in patients with other neurological disorders. And there were three findings. First of all, you see here, there's no difference between BBBB and other vestibular disorders. That means that there's no specific vitamin D deficiency. Secondly, other neurological disorders where a lot of patients with dementia at a lower level. And thirdly, there was no difference between those with first episode and those with recurrent BBBB. So I think if a patient has vitamin D deficiency, substituted, but not specifically for BBBB. Now this paper, we just got accepted in JAMA Neurology. And this shows the strength of remote management. Because this patient had in sequence posterior canal, horizontal canal, anterior canal, and showed the treatment maneuvers. And JAMA was very impressed by this sequence. And it shows how important remote management is to make a precise diagnosis and to check whether the patient is performing the maneuvers correctly or not. What all patients should get is a follow-up appointment. Let's say Monday you see a patient, BBBB, and give the patient an appointment in 8 days' time to check whether he or she is appropriately treated. Very important. And here the summary for your clinical practice. Posterior canal, simul plus, horizontal canal, modified roll maneuver, anterior canal, modified Iacovino maneuver, and no specific vitamin D deficiency. Now we move over to another disease, which is the second most frequent cause of vertigo. It's Meniere's disease. Prosper Meniere, 1861, January the 8th, was not the first one to describe these symptoms, but his contribution was, he examined the ear of these patients and he said, this is not a neurological disease, this is an ear disease. That was his contribution. And therefore, Jean-Martin Charcot named it 1874, Maladie de Meniere. And that's the reason why it's called Meniere's disease. Here are the diagnostic criteria. They're very simple and very pragmatic. What you need is an audiogram. The audiogram can also be taken by the patient by himself. We have a lot of very good audio apps, for instance, the Mimi Hearing app. The Mimi Hearing app can be used by the patient, and you can also split the result for different frequencies, 250, 500, 1,000, 2 to 8,000 hertz. And you see a patient who documented his hearing during an episode, and you see clear here, it goes down by minus 40 decibel. And the second episode was the same. So that strongly supports the diagnosis. Another way of remote management is patients take a video during an episode of vertigo, and that helps to make the diagnosis. Again, this patient had a right-sided Meniere's disease with a fast pace and beating towards a more active labyrinth in the acute phase. So use your smartphone in a smart way. That will help. If a patient comes with recurrent episodes of vertigo, you see a long list of differential diagnoses. So peripheral vestibular disorders, central imaging in vestibular migraine. One technology has been heavily promoted, and this is visualization of endolymphatic high drops. But this is not part of the diagnostic criteria because it's not specific. 40% of all patients with vestibular schwannoma have endolymphatic high drops, so it's not really helpful. You don't need to do that. And this is also stated in our current opinions in neurology article in 2019 and in a more recent editorial in the American Journal of Neuroradiology. So there's no need for visualization of endolymphatic high drops. And here are two statements, formal logic. Endolymphatic high drops is a necessary but not a sufficient condition for Meniere's disease. Got it? There has to be more. And secondly, don't make a mistake in terms of categories. Endolymphatic high drops is a morphological finding, it's not a disease. And if you follow both of these statements, there will be no confusion. Formal logic for bright Indian doctors. Good. Now I come to something which is also very helpful for your practice. We did a worldwide survey and looked how doctors treat vestibular disorders. And we got a response from 234 key opinion leaders in 188 centers from 47 countries. Here you see all the different countries, so China, US, Japan, Brazil. And when it comes to surgical intervention, you see a broad spectrum of measures and none of them is really effective, or the other one destroy labyrinthine function. So that's not a good way to treat patients, no surgery. If we look at pharmacotherapy, again, you see a very broad spectrum of drugs which have been used, and at least 76% use betahistine. So there must be something behind betahistine in the treatment of Meniere's disease. Here you see a summary of measures which for we do not have any evidence of clinical efficacy. And it's a long list. And this list is based on placebo-controlled trials, which is very important. I'll come to that in a few moments. So no evidence for surgery, salt, coffee, alcohol-free diet, diuretics, Meniere device, or intratympanic dexamethasone. The latter study is extremely important because it's one of the very few well-designed studies. So they had a clinically relevant endpoint, days with vertigo. They had an evidently sufficient long period of treatment, 3 months, and they had a placebo group and 80 patients in each cohort. What do you see? There's no difference between placebo and intratympanic dexamethasone. There's a strong placebo effect of 60%. So they're very good doctors and very good pills, but it's all placebo. And this we have to consider in every trial. And now look at this paper, which was published in The Lancet by colleagues from London. And The Lancet is localized in London. Look at the data here. This is a long observational period, 18 to 24 months. And you see gentamicin and methylprednisolone, and you see there's no difference. If you go now back to this and you extrapolate this, you end up with the same low rate. So this is probably all placebo effect and not a treatment effect. So I think we have to restart again and look for reasonable treatment. The European position paper recommends betahistine 48 milligrams three times per day. We got the impression that the higher dosages are much more effective than the lower dosages. Higher dosage means 96 TID as the appetizer. You see here, the majority of these 136 patients were happy with this dosage. The basic problem with betahistine, and it's the same with L-DOPA, is its metabolism. Betahistine is metabolized by 99% in the gastrointestinal tract by monoamine oxidase B. Do you know any monoamine oxidase B inhibitor? Any drug which inhibits the monoamine oxidase B? Neurologists here? Cilaginine and rasaginine. And that's the perspective for the treatment of Meniere's disease, this combination of both drugs. Now listen to this.
Mr. Todd, you've had Meniere's disease since 2013. How many attacks did you have per month, more or less, before we started the treatment? Just under 30, about 27 to 30. Then we slowly increased the betahistine dose to 30 tablets per day and then to 50 tablets per day. How many attacks did you have per month while taking 50 tablets per day? About 8 per month. And now you're on two 24 milligram betahistine tablets plus one selegiline tablet in the morning. Yes. When was the last attack? It was about 3 years ago. What's happened to your hearing and your right ear? My hearing's got better. Do you get any side effects from the combined treatment? No, no side effects whatsoever. And how are you doing now? Great. Thank you.
So this is the future, I think. And we did a case series of 13 patients. We could go down to 20% of the initial dosage. But here again, the mean dosage was 200 milligrams. Okay. And consequently, we performed a phase one trial in 15 healthy volunteers, and then looked at the plasma concentration of betahistine with and without cilaginine. And this was beyond our expectations because the bioavailability increases by a factor of 100. So here in black, you can hardly measure the concentration without, but with, it's much, 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 much higher. And based on that, we are going to perform a placebo-controlled trial. Mechanism of action, well, we demonstrated that betahistine increases cochlear blood flow, was dose-dependent, but the major effect is probably a different one. Indirectly, betahistine releases a lot of histamine, and this activates the histamine 1 receptor, and this is found in a very high density in the endolymphatic membrane. And if you activate the H1 receptor, you increase membrane permeability and endolymphatic cytokines. So that's the most likely mechanism of action of betahistine. So this is for your take-home slide. So the 4 Ds, correct diagnosis, correct drug, dosage at least 144 milligrams, plus 5 milligrams cilaginine or 1 milligram rasaginine. What you should not do is give a very low dosage of betahistine. It will not be effective. We tried that, it was not effective. And the upcoming trial, a phase 2B placebo controlled trial, here's the study design, will be done probably with 96 milligram TID plus 5 milligram cilaginine. The only wanted side effect is headache, which you can avoid here in India by using the sustained release form, because you saw this peak in the concentration. If you give 6 tablets of the sustained release form per day, plus 1 of cilaginine, that's evidently the worldwide best way to treat patients with Meniere's disease. Good, and now we move on to the next patient. Listen to him carefully and try to make the diagnosis.
Mr. Strand, you come to us because you are suffering from recurrent attacks of vertigo. How long do they last?
They last normally between 5 and 10 minutes, rarely 1 to 70 minutes, or mostly 5 to 10 minutes.
Do you have any other additional symptoms during these attacks?
No.
Do they occur spontaneously?
Sometimes they are spontaneously, sometimes maybe they are triggered by stress. I cannot definitely say.
Thank you very much.
So, recurrent episodes of vertigo, short lasting, most often occurring spontaneously. Now have a look at the patient's eye movements taken by himself. As a spontaneous nystagmus, not very pronounced, but this speaks definitely against a panic attack. Yeah, so it's an organic disease. By the way, what would you diagnose from the options you have? We have still 4 options. What do you diagnose? What is it? Vestibular paroxysm. Yeah, actually, probable vestibular paroxysm, because we don't have the results of the treatment yet. The drug of choice are sodium channel blocker, namely lacosamide. I'll come to that in a few moments. And now I come to a misdiagnosis, which is based on imaging. 45% of all of us have a close contact between the 8th cranial nerve and the eye cuff. And if you misinterpret that in a patient with vertigo as vestibular paroxysmia, something may happen, as in this patient. Listen to this gentleman. What happened to him?
Mr. Thomas, which symptoms bring you to see us?
Well, I often have vertigo attacks that last some time.
What is the minimum maximum duration?
Minimum is half an hour to an hour, and maximum is sometimes 6 hours.
Are there any additional ear complaints before, during, or after the attacks?
Well, I always have a feeling of numbness. I have a high rate of tinnitus, high frequency, and up to and including a feeling of pressure in my ears.
How is your hearing going?
I may still hear 10% on the left side.
How many years have you had the attacks?
I've had the attacks for a few years now, for about 3 to 4 years. And I've had the inability to hear for about 3 years now.
What have you been diagnosed with?
First and foremost, Meniere's disease, which was treated with betahistine. Betahistine really affects me.
What was then diagnosed?
Then I was at a vertigo outpatient clinic in Sinsheim, where a vestibular proxemia was diagnosed.
And what was done about it?
After that, I was treated again with carbamazepine. I also tolerated the carbamazepine badly on site. The complaints did not get better. So I went to the hospital in Regensburg, and then I had some surgery there.
And after the operation, has anything changed?
No, it actually got worse.
Thank you very much.
So this has happened to several patients. So that was perfect surgery, not micro, but macro surgery, as you see here. This was done based on the imaging. So what counts primarily is the patient history and the response to the sodium channel blocker to support the diagnosis of vestibular paroxysmia. We published a randomized placebo-controlled trial with ox carbazepine. The dropout rate was 60%, so patients don't like it. Drug of choice, which is also available here from Abbott, is lacosamide, 200 to 400 milligrams per day. And this is much, much better tolerated. And this is, by the way, also my recommendation for trigeminal neuralgia, and also hemifacial spasm and glossopharyngeal neuralgia. So compliance, adherence, persistence is much, much better. So here's a summary. Recurrent episodes of spontaneously occurring vertigo, short duration. During an attack, you see spontaneous nystagmus. Mechanism is compression of the H cranial nerve, specifically the central part, which is covered by oligodendrocytes, so for perfectionists. Vestibular paroxysm is a central vestibular disorder, and treatment of choice is lacosamide. Okay, now a case which we published in Neurology. 47-year-old patient who can hear his own eye movements in his left ear. What do you diagnose? He went to psychiatry for 6 weeks. Of course, he did not improve. What do you diagnose? So a syndrome of the third mobile windows. And this phenomenon is called autophonia, or as the Americans say, autophony. Yeah? Hearing own body voice. And this is very embarrassing for the patients. I had a patient from South Africa, she was treated. She had an enlarged vestibular aqueduct syndrome, and there was a permanent and then drove her crisis. She was triathlon champion before in South Africa. She's now treated and she's back on track. Yeah. So listen to this patient here, and I'll show you a new test with a very simple and cheap device.
In this patient, we test the somatosensory system by using our tuning fork. We put it on the sternum. Where do you hear the sound now?
Left ear.
Now we put it on the medial malleolus. Where do you hear the sound?
Left ear.
So this causes an unusual symptom.
Ha, super. What? Due to a negative bone conduction, this patient could hear all the body voices in the left ear. And that's a typical phenomenon. And this little tuning fork allows you to make a more precise diagnosis. You see again a nystagmus. And if you remember what you saw in anterior canal BPPV, it's exactly the same. It's the excitation of the anterior canal. Vertical torsional nystagmus. And for those who use vestibular evoked myogenic potentials, as we showed in a statement paper by the American Academy of Neurology, the major indication for these vestibular evoked myogenic potentials is the syndrome of the third mobile window. You have increased amplitude of the ocular vestibular evoked myogenic potentials. If this is higher than 70 microvolts, the diagnosis is strongly supported. Here you see the audiogram. See here, negative bone conduction in the low frequency range. Yeah? And that's the explanation for autophony. We can have a superior cerebral canal syndrome. But look here, what is in this patient? Which canal is affected? Look at the nystagmus. We saw similar nystagmus before. What is the direction? Linear horizontal. Which canal is affected? A horizontal canal on the right side. Fast phase is beating towards a more active labyrinth. So the direction of the nystagmus allows you to determine which canal and which site is affected. And here are the diagnostic criteria. And for reasons, they are a little bit lengthy, not to make a mistake, to overlook and not to misdiagnose. Unfortunately, most of these patients are diagnosed as psychiatric, somatoform, functional, dizziness, and whatsoever. Because the history is so strange, but once you have diagnosed one of these patients, that will be deja vu for you for the next patient. So in every unclear, dizzy patient, consider the syndrome of the third mobile windows and do all these tests. The leading symptom is sound or pressure-induced vertigo, bone conduction hyperacusis, and here nystagmus provoked in the plane of the affected canal, negative bone conduction, and enhanced ramp responses. The CT per se is not sufficient. Why? Because 2% of all of us, we have a CT which looks like superior canal Nielsen syndrome. And we have patients who also got surgery, but they had something else. And here's a gentleman sitting who was able to do the surgery. So you're in a lucky position.
This patient would complain of dizziness
from South Africa, really with my
left ear. This is a recording of his left eye.
There was mobile phone induced vertigo and oscillopsia.
A metal cranial fossa approach was utilized to identify the dehiscence. Care should be taken not to tear the membranes of the endolymphatic system. The dehiscence can be addressed in different ways. It can be plugged with soft tissue. It can be resurfaced using bone patella as in this case. Or it can be capped with a piece of bone.
So which technique do you apply?
With the bone cement and soft tissue.
How many patients did you treat so far?
My experience is two patients.
Two patients.
In fellowship, I've seen the long.
And they're all well. All went well. Yeah, so the surgery is not that easy, I think. And sometimes patients leave the theater worse than before. But you evidently have someone here who's able to do that. Patients need surgery if they are severely impaired. And not every patient with this syndrome, on the other hand, needs surgery. Okay, now we move over to the last patient and listen to this gentleman in the left upper corner.
Goats, which symptoms do you have that you've come to us?
Vertigo and walking disorders.
How long have you had these symptoms?
For a good 3 years now.
How is it when you're lying and sitting down?
It's okay when I'm lying and sitting down.
Standing?
Actually, standing too, with slight back and forth movements.
How is it when walking?
When I walk, I notice when I'm not focused, for example, that I break out to the left.
How about walking in the dark or on an uneven surface?
Then it's even more difficult for me, because I notice that I really fluctuate then. And the bottom line is that it's very difficult without light.
How about cycling, if you have to stop suddenly?
When cycling, it is very difficult to focus. You also have eye movements, so a vibration is the bottom line.
Thank you very much.
So, what do you diagnose? Any ideas? Downbeat is a good differential diagnosis for persisting dizziness. Bilateral vestibulopathy. And here are the leading symptoms: imbalance, chronic dizziness, 50% have osteopsia, and 1/3 have recurrent episodes of vertigo before, which indicates that there's a lesion on the right left side leading to transient vestibular tonic balance. This is the head impulse test, and the head impulse test is often not clear. You can have false pathological findings or false negative findings. And to make a precise diagnosis, you need the video head impulse test, which we have here in the center. If the gain is below 0.6 on both sides, you can make the diagnosis. Here was the gain 0.17, 0.13. There's one thing which is important for you to know. There are patients who have a normal head impulse test and pathological calorics. So if you suspect bilateral vestibulopathy, the video head impulse test is normal, you have to add the calorics. That's the logic sequence. Namely, patients with bilateral Meniere's disease can have that. And here are the diagnostic criteria. So chronic vestibular syndrome, uncertain of stance or gait. Movement-induced oscillopsia, worsening in darkness and on uneven ground, and VOR gain below 0.6. Okay, leading symptom was persisting dizziness or imbalance, primary, secondary combination of both. And here a list of diseases which are characterized by persisting dizziness. And that's extremely important for you to know that we have just three categories. Sensory deficit, bilateral vestibulopathy, movement disorders and or cerebellar dizziness, and finally functional dizziness. So these are the three categories for your diagnostic approach in patients with persisting dizziness. Okay, We are now approaching the end of this lecture. And I'll show you one patient here. He's severely impaired. And look how he's walking.
Okay, okay.
So he can't walk without help. Is this bilateral vestibulopathy only? Or is there something more? As a cerebellar ataxia, yeah? And then we come to something which is characterized by the combination of a vestibular deficit plus cerebellar ocular motor disorder. You see here this patient has a downbeat nystagmus and a pathological head pulsus. And we already described such cases in 2007, 2008, later in 2011. And then there was one case published with a histopathological confirmation, and that was the basis for the syndrome cerebellar ataxia with neuropathy and bilateral vestibular areflexia syndrome CAVAS. Genetic testing has become more and more important in many neurological diseases, including also vestibular diseases and cerebellar diseases. And here, 2019, two groups, one from UK and one from Australia, published approximately at the same time the mutations in the so-called regulatory factor C1, which is important for DNA repair. And these mutations lead to the combination of cerebellar ataxia, neuropathy, and vestibular areflexia. We did a study here and had a look at a huge cohort, and it turned out that only 66% of patients with a phenotype of CANVAS have mutations. However, if you have a patient with something which is called ataxia with chronic cough, they all have this mutation. And this is because the neuropathy also affects vegetative ganglia, leading to chronic cough. So it's not a tick, it's an organic disease. And for the patients, it's a great relief if you tell them, this is not psychiatry, this is neurology. And some break out in tears because they know I have no tick, I have something which is organic. And therefore it's important to do that. And the phenotype also overlaps with multiple system atrophy. So this replication factor C1, it's a DNA polymerase accessory protein synthesis and repair of DNA, chromosome 4p14. It's not specific for CANVAS. What is the treatment of bilateral vestibulopathy? Well, first of all, it's very frequent. And the treatment of choice is explain the disease to the patient. Explanation is always the therapeutic principle number one. Patients have to exactly know what they're suffering from. That helps a lot. And then daily, permanent, and lifelong balance training. And listen to this patient here.
Mr. Polta, you suffer from gentamicin-induced bilateral vestibulopathy. In November of last year, we recommended balance training, which you have also implemented in an exemplary manner. How long did it take until you noticed a noticeable improvement?
Approximately 6 weeks.
Then it slowly got better? Did you then reach a plateau at some point where it didn't get any better?
In February of this year.
Is there also a reason why it didn't get any better?
Yes. I had been previously training intensively in the gym, and then could not train as I had been doing due to COVID.
And then there was a particularly good development recently?
Yes, I dared to go on my bike and have been riding, but initially only in our housing development with little car traffic.
Wonderful. Thank you.
So, consultation is extremely important, but this is not limited to bilateral vestibulopathy, what I call the cap of every treatment, compliance, adherence, and persistence. This is extremely, extremely important. Consider that you cannot overdo the consultation with the patient. Good, so here again, the summary of bilateral vestibulopathy. So it's a postural imbalance of a chronic vestibular syndrome, pathological head impulse test for calorics, 75 idiopathic. We found mutation in 25% now. And the treatment is explanation and balance training daily and lifelong. So I'd like to summarize a little bit the key features of what we discussed during the last 75 minutes. So for acute unilateral stimulopathy, we have a gene. Steroids are effective. Beta-histine is effective in a high dosage. BPPV, Simon Plus, modified role maneuver, modified Jacobino maneuver. Meniere's disease, intertympanic dexamethasone, not effective, but is effective in high dosages and or combination of MAO-B inhibitor. Vestibular paroxysmia, lacosamide, superior canal dehiscence, use your tuning fork, and bilateral vestibulopathy, lifelong balance training. So, any questions from the audience or from the chat room related to peripheral vestibular disorders? I have a microphone here, I'll come to you, and you can ask your questions. Any questions? Any questions in the chat room, gentlemen? No? Okay, so it's a quiet and peaceful Saturday afternoon. You're all tired from work with very high workload, and now you sit here relaxed, waiting for your 5 o'clock tea with some cookies. Yeah, that's a good question. The question was about nystagmus negative BPPV. Well, in BPPV, there's no nystagmus, by the way. So that's true. You have a patient who comes and tells you, I have recurrent episodes of vertigo. Typically in the morning when I get up, I turn around in bed, you do the diagnostic maneuvers, and the patient on the right side tells you, oh, now I have short vertigo. And when he gets up again, short vertigo, and then a tendency to fall backward. If you do the diagnostic maneuvers to the left, everything is fine. This is probable BPPV on the right side. What is your diagnostic approach? Well, you show the patient how to perform the diagnostic maneuvers. Secondly, the patient should perform them for 10 days. If they can induce vertigo again on the right side, then they should do the therapeutic maneuvers. If not, they cure themselves. So there's something like another differential diagnosis is orthostatic dizziness, of course. In BPPV, you typically induce the symptoms when the patient lies down, also when he gets up. In orthostatic, always when he gets up from the right and from the left. So a little clinical hint to discriminate BPPV from orthostatic dizziness. Any other questions? Nothing? Okay. Yes, sir. Sorry, I didn't see you. Functional dizziness, that's a very important question. So now I'm your patient, and you ask me what I'm suffering from.
You have dizziness?
I have dizziness now for 2 years.
Any specific timing?
Well, it's less in the morning. When I get up, it's better, but during the day, it's getting worse and worse.
How long does it last?
It's a whole day.
Symptoms like vomiting
or no, nothing whatsoever.
Your complaints?
No, nothing.
Headache?
No headache.
Any episodes?
Oh, it's not permanent, every day, 7 days a week. Now we have a consultation. Any other questions for the patient? Do you have more questions? Anybody else? There must be more because we have positive criteria for functional dizziness. Oh yeah, that's a good question. Now that they mention it. So when I'm skiing, everything is fine in Gulmark. Snow was horribly bad last time. But when I wait downstairs on the lift, for the lift, then I'm totally dizzy. But skiing goes very well, and also the half pipe, all is good. But waiting in the lift and in the lift, it's even worse. And I noticed a small amount of alcohol. So a Kingfisher beer, and I'm feeling better. Any other questions?
What do you do to get rid of it?
Alcohol is not a treatment. So actually, I avoid certain situations. I don't go shopping anymore. So my mother is doing that. Good Indian mother. I hardly leave the house. Now I work home office, which is all good, but when I leave the house, but as I said, doing sports, it's okay. No grocery shopping, nothing. Any other questions for this patient? We have a concilium now. We all came to some. Do you know what symposium means? From Greek, having a drink together. Symposium. Okay, concilium is something different. Okay, like concerto means fighting together. Good. Any other questions for this patient? Positive criteria. What is your primary personality? Oh, well, I'm a mechanical engineer. I'm a perfectionist. I work very hard, 8 days a week, and I permanently observe my balance. So everybody, please get up. We do a simple test. Everybody, you too. Nice that you mentioned functional dizziness. Okay, now don't touch the chairs and nothing else. Both legs together. And now close your eyes. Close your eyes. And check your balance. Do you sway a little bit? If not, you have Parkinson's. Everybody is swaying, which is physiological. Okay. And if you now interpret this swaying as dizziness or vertigo, then you're on a good way to develop functional dizziness, because that's the basic problem of these patients. So they start checking their own balance. And if you do so, you notice this normal physiological swaying, which we have, everybody. Normally, you do not become aware of it. But if you become aware of it, you will interpret this as dizziness. And then you feel dizzy. The more dizzy you feel, the more you check your own balance. And then you have a co-contraction. Maybe you feel it already, of the agonist and antagonist, yeah? And this is the way to become another 50 functional dizziness patient here for the dizziness center. Okay, good, please take your seat. So now we get an idea about it. So it's the most frequent cause of postural imbalance. It can be primary or it can be secondary. And it's very frequent in patients who have episodic vertigo, like vestibular migraine, like vestibular paroxysmia, like Meniere's disease. Or it can happen after syncope or after a period of acute unilateral vestibulopathy. Personality traits are like most of us, perfectionists, introspection, a little bit anarchistic, correct? There's another candidate like me. Less symptoms in the early morning, which we showed in a nice study. We had three cohorts. Patients with downbeat, they have more symptoms in the morning than is adaptation. Functional dizziness, less, because then they move out their sensors. And bilateral, they were dizzy all day long, worsening at the end of the day, they get tired. Then ask the patient for modulating factors, sports, alcohol, distraction, and also for avoidance behavior and for depression. The latter question is important for your pharmacotherapy. If a patient has anxiety with that, things like that, patient may get amitriptyline. If the patient has panic attacks with that, patients get an SSRI, like acetaminophen. The treatment response is quite high, although there's no placebo-controlled trial yet. Next year, we will start one, a three-arm placebo-controlled trial with escitalopram and another phototherapeuticum. But some patients need pharmacotherapy. So be aware of that. And I think in India, it's even more frequent. Maybe it's in Bangalore, even more frequent than here because of all these IT guys. But everybody of us can have that. And this is something you can tell the patient beforehand. If you identify the personality and then say to the patient, well, you have a high risk that you will develop this type of dizziness. If they're aware of it, the risk is much lower. Okay, any other good questions on the new for all that question?
Can I just comment on the system? Persistent, but posture.
Okay, this is a super term. PPPD, triple PDB, the double PD, such and such. There was a nice study in the in an Indian colony called United Kingdom these days. I thought that would provoke a reaction. I would take a while. Okay, I'm really tired, I see that. So the non-tax-paying woman of the, okay, good. Or the husband of the non-tax-paying Indian rich lady. Okay, anyway, patients don't like the term triple PD. They cannot identify it, and I always get confused. Persistent, perceived, postural, perceived, or triple PD. I was co-author of the paper. I didn't like it. And we have different subtypes. The best term is you call it functional dizziness. This is neutral, and it will not damage the doctor-patient relationship from the first minute on. And you need another half an hour to get that fixed. But functional dizziness iterates how important the person is with his personality, and then you have the same level to talk about the disease. And then the cure rate is about 70%. And then we have the subtypes, including mild Wagner syndrome and also visually induced dizziness, WPD, triple PD. It has no consequences for the therapy. Any other good question?
Benzodiazepines are what
in the role? Benzodiazepines normally I do not prescribe, except for epileptic seizures. You can give them, in a way, patient with panic attacks. If they have it in the pocket, that's sufficient. They know they can take it when they need it, but most often they don't take it. Yeah, but otherwise, I'm not a great fan of benzodiazepines.
Any drugs that can cause use vertigo?
Oh yes, if you have a look at the description of drugs, 90% can cause dizziness, but that's most often not the cause of dizziness in these patients. Yeah. Typical drugs, of course, are antihypertensives, antiarrhythmic drugs, namely amiodarone, which causes bilateral vestibulopathy, accumulates also in the cerebellum, can cause cerebellar ataxia, gentamicin is a classic candidate, diuretics also. So we have a list of 10 relevant, and most frequent one are anti-epileptic drugs, phenytoin, carbamazepine, fluoxetine. They make you really drowsy and dizzy. How do you say dizzy in Hindi? Chekha, I remember that. Okay, good. Any questions related to Chekha?
So, my name is Dr. Sam, pediatrician. So for the last 4 months, I'm having some tedious, some dizzy. So I went to Ravi also that time. So it may never, that time it was not there, but at that time morning I had. So for the last 4 months, I'm getting, but it's intermittent, it's not epileptic.
And
it's
morning
vertigo.
Morning,
morning, especially.
When you lie down, when you turn around in bed.
No, bed it's on. So, the bath, especially.
After bath.
Yeah. So I noticed that.
That can be orthostatic dizziness. Do you do some exercise, sports?
Do you take any medication? How's your blood pressure? Okay, so it can be orthostatic dizziness, what you describe. And then we do a so-called shadow test or a head tilt or the body tilt test, and then we can fix it. More exercise would be fine. Running every day, 2 hours. And it will go away. Any other questions? Okay, if this is not the case, I think I got.
What?
Okay, this you can have in a patient who has an aortic stenosis with some cardiac problems, cardiac insufficiency. But also patients who have stenosis here, vertebrovascular stenosis. In a broader sense, it's also subclavian steel syndrome. We do this. So this is mainly primary or secondary vascular and cardiogenic. Well, changes of pressure, of course, we always have to consider in the direction of the syndrome of the third mobile windows. Yeah.
What's your opinion on yoga as a preventive practice?
Yoga. I can show you three videos. The downward facing dog is a typical maneuver to induce BPPV. I skipped the videos. I had three patients in a row. And so I don't know how this maneuver looks like, but maybe someone can show it sooner or later to me. Then I know. But that's a typical provoking maneuver, downward facing dog for yoga. Yoga by itself is good for your balance, for sure. And namely because we noticed in a Lancet paper that slow movements are much more demanding than fast movements. This is also reflected by the fact that patients who have bilateral vestibulopathy, when they run, they feel much better. When they go slowly, they have more balance problems. This is because running is generated by spinal automated locomotor pattern, which do not depend very much on vestibular input. But if you go slowly, you depend more on vestibular input. And therefore, you're better off running was the title of this Lancet paper with a dog, actually. Tessa was her name. Good. Questions are coming up from the chat room. Gentlemen? Nothing? Okay. I think then we can close the session. It was great to have you here, and I hope you learned a lot. And we will work on the infrastructure and the human resources of the new business center here in Hyderabad. Thank you very much. Shukriya. Namaste. Namaste.
It was an excellent presentation, Professor Strupp. We are really honored, and we were fortunate to hear your experiences and practical tips and update on the diagnosis and treatment of vertigo. Thank you so much.